Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome you into the house of the Lord this morning. So Pastor Nate was actually originally scheduled to be here this morning, but I don't know if you knew. He went up to the Packers game yesterday, and a little bit of a disappointment if you watched the game. It was a close one. It was tough, but I told him that he needed to go and be at Lambeau Field for his first time ever, so I'm sure he loved it. So we'll pray that he has safe travels back today and that his time with his brother was blessed and exciting. A couple of announcements for you this morning. The Valentine Vendor Fair is coming up. That will be on Saturday, February 12th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. There's going to be all kinds of vendors there. Erie Lane's the one I know, or the most familiar with. It's going to be a fundraiser for our school auction, so please come out and support our school and get some cool Valentine's crafts. Also this week coming up is the Lutheran Schools Week. So all across the nation, Lutheran schools will be having devotions, pondering all the success and all the many blessings that God gives to us through our Lutheran schools as we raise young people in the faith. So keep all the Lutheran schools in your prayers this week, that they would have a meaningful week of reflection and as they continue to create future disciples for Christ. In the general announcements, a couple of things I'll point out for you. So the first thing is just a simple reminder, the fellowship pads are in the pews, and we ask that you would fill those out. It helps us keep better track of attendance that way, numbers-wise. Your contribution statements are also on the back table in the back of the narthex, so those are there to pick up. Lutheran witness renewals are being inquired for. The deadline seems to be Sunday, January 30th, 2022. An important announcement for the Taste of Tuesday, the ladies wanted me to let you know that with the prevalence of the coronavirus lately, that they've made the decision to cancel this month's dinner out. So the dinner for January 25th has been canceled, but they'll meet once again in February, date to be determined. The school will also be doing dine-out nights to support the school's spirit nights. The first spirit night's going to be on Thursday, January 27th from 4 to 8 p.m. Cardinals calendars are still for sale if you are so inclined to get one of those. Christian Friends of New America are still asking for donations of shoes, coats, and blankets. There's a contact number for Laura if you have specific questions. One final thing I'll put forth is Beautiful Savior Lutheran Church in Bridgeton, Missouri. It's a smaller family church, but they're looking for a substitute organist and pianist, someone who can cover for occasional midweek worships, funerals, and the like. So if you happen to know someone who's maybe looking to get some more organ playing time, just let them know that Beautiful Savior's looking. With that is all of my announcements this morning. We begin with our opening hymn.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The law is holy, and the commandment is holy, and righteous and good. But I see in my members another law, waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Let us confess our sins to God, our merciful Father. To you, O God, we confess that we have sinned against you in our thoughts, words, and deeds, and also by the good that we have failed to do. Our love for you and for our neighbors has been weak or even dead. By your law, you reveal the judgment we rightly deserve. Because your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, has fulfilled your law on our behalf, we beg your forgiveness and grace to restore us to life with you in the fellowship of all believers.
Amen.
In the mercy of our Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Be with you. Let us pray. Lord God, your word clearly shows your love for the world, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Give to us both heartfelt repentance and faith, that we may rejoice together and praise your goodness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. The Old Testament reading for this morning comes from the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8. And all the people gathered as one man into the square before the water gate. And they told Ezra, the scribe, to bring the book of the law of Moses that the Lord had commanded Israel. So Ezra, the priest, brought the law before the assembly, both men and women, and all who could understand what they heard, on the first day of the seventh month. And he read from it, facing the square before the water gate, from early morning until midday, in the presence of the men and the women and those who could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people. And as he opened it, all the people stood. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. And all the people answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands. And they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. They read from the book, from the law of God, clearly. And they gave the sense, so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra, the priest and scribe, and the Levites, who taught the people, said to all of the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept as they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, Go your way, eat the fat and drink sweet wine, and send portions to anyone who has nothing ready. For this day is holy to our Lord. And do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm for this morning is Psalm 19, and is spoken responsibly. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. There is no speech, nor are there words, whose voice is not heard.
Their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set the tent for the sun.
Which comes out like a bridegroom, leaving his chamber, and like a strong man, runs its course with joy. Is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing in heart. The command of the Lord is pure, abiding in matters.
The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Is your servant warned? In keeping them, there is great reward. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. The epistle reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and is also the basis of today's message. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body.
And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And on those parts of the body that we think less honorable, we bestow the greater honor. And our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Now you, beloved, are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administrating, and various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the higher gifts. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I invite the congregation to rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the fourth chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. As was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. And all spoke well of him, and marveled at the gracious words that were coming from his mouth. And they said amongst themselves, is not this Joseph's son? And Jesus said to them, doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, physician, heal yourself. What we have heard you did at Capernaum, do here in your hometown as well. And Jesus said, truly I say to you, no prophet is acceptable in his hometown. But in truth, I tell you, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heavens were shut up 3 years and 6 months, and a great famine came over all the land. And Elijah was sent to none of them, but only to Zarephath, in the land of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And there were many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian. When the people heard these things, all in the synagogue were filled with wrath. And they rose up, and they drove Jesus out of the town, and brought him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they could throw him down the cliff. But passing through their midst, Jesus went away. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We continue at this time with the confession of faith and the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you for gathering the body of Christ today here in this house. Lord, open our ears, our hearts, and our minds to the preaching of your word. Lord, may you dispel any spirit of wickedness in our hearts that allows us to say to one another, I don't need you, to a body, to a member of the body of Christ. Lord, for the truth that you revealed to us this morning is that we are all one, and we cannot say such things to one another. If one part of us is suffering, we all suffer. If one part of us is honored, we are all honored. So keep this spirit of unity in our hearts and our minds this day. Lord, may the offering that we lift up to you this morning be one of unity. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, I would like to invite any children up for the children's message. Continue with our sermon. Peace and blessings to the church, the one body of Jesus Christ, with many members. Amen. When was the last time that your feet talked to your hands? Or when was the last time that your eyes spoke to your ears? Or what about your nose? With what part of your body has it communicated? Believe it or not, your body parts do talk to one another. Most of the time, we don't remember this fact until the hands or the feet or some other part of the body is hurting or in pain. I experienced this firsthand this past summer, for example. I wasn't paying attention to where I was walking. I wasn't aware of where I was going. And I stubbed my pinky toe really hard into the door frame of my room. And suddenly, I got the message. Immediately, the most important part of my body was my little toe. It demanded all of my attention as I screamed in pain. In fact, it captured my attention for about a month. Yep, it talked to the rest of my body all the time. Every time that I tried to put on a shoe, every time that I tried to walk a distance of sorts, or even every time I grazed it on an object, even slightly, it talked. I was amazed at how many things I did with my pinky toe, how much I took it for granted. And now, because it was broken, it caused great struggle within me when I tried to do anything. You have this same feeling when you have a cold or a sinus infection, don't you? It seems to be that your nose is somehow communicating its discomfort to the rest of your body as you have the chills or feelings of sickness. Or what about with back? When your back is sore, when your back is jammed, when it's in pain, it's as if it's spreading up your spine to every single part of your body, screaming in pain. I could go on and on with examples that have the parts of our body talking to one another. It's true, beloved, no matter how old you are, no matter how young you are, there are days when the various parts of your body send a whole bunch of messages to the other parts. And there are times, beloved, when you wish that those parts of your body would just be removed from you. There are times you want to cut off those parts that are hurting. There are times that we forget that all the parts of our body are important, from our eyes, our ears, the heart, to our little toe. And that's what Paul is trying to explain to us this morning. Paul says in the reading, if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be a part of the body. This is true also in the church, which Paul here in his first letter to the Corinthians calls the body of Christ. How much more beautifully, in fact, can anyone show or display or speak about the interconnectedness of the parts of the members of the church than Paul, who is telling us this morning that we are one functional unit made of different parts. And yet, though we are different, though we have different gifts and different talents, we all use them as one church body. So it is with Christ. Beloved, you are the body of Christ. Each one of you is a part of it. Each one of you has something to offer. So what is the point of what Paul is saying to us? Paul is telling us that we are members of Christ's body. We're connected to one another just as parts of the body are connected to together. And what's more, what does this mean for us going forward? Well, it means that you can't cut off those parts that are hurting. It means that you can't do away with the parts that you don't like. There is no way that you can be a part of the Christian church. There's no way that you can consider yourself a member of Christ if you say to another part of the body of Christ, I do not need you. Because you see, the church's greatest strength, its fundamental building block, is its interconnectedness, its unity. It's being built on the one single foundation of Jesus Christ. Note this, beloved, that Paul does not say that the church should be one body. Paul says that the church is one body. The unity of the church is a fact to be recognized. It's not some idealized goal that we push towards. It's something that we are. You can't take it away. You can't subtract from it. It doesn't work that way. So when the mission of the church is blessed in one place, the whole entire church rejoices. And by contrast, when scandals and sinfulness rises within a part of the church, everyone within it is affected. It's everyone's problem. As Paul says, if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. And if one part is honored, every part is honored with it. How much clearer, beloved, can Paul make this when he writes to us this morning? Now the body is not made up of one part, but of many. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But God, in his infinite wisdom, has in fact arranged the parts of the body, every one of them just as he wanted them to be. Again, so it is with the church. The whole cannot do without the parts. The parts cannot do without the whole. This is true of any Christian church. It's true of any gathering Christ. It's true of any gathering that is founded on Jesus. But what the church so often forgets and needs to frequently be reminded of is that we need each other in order to function as Christ's body. Beloved, I know that I personally need each and every one of you. You also need me. And you also need one another. The need can never flow just one way. It must always be a two-way street between us, a two-way street of communication and love and compassion. Because unity comes only from Christ and his giving himself up for the other, as he first did when he lived, when he died, and he rose again for you. Unity comes through Christ, through his love, through his mercies. It gets rid of all of our selfishness and pride that prevents us from being one with each other. It all begins, it all ends on the firm foundation of Christ. And I want to make this point more clear to you by sharing a real life example, one that I grew up with, and one that has hit me hard to the heart to this day. It's an example of the dismay that I feel when the body of Christ is not founded in love, when the body of Christ isn't founded on communication, when a spirit of unity, disunity, enters the church. So there was once a church that was well represented across all age groups and generational differences. But one day, the church wanted to pursue something new. A small group of younger adult members decided that they wanted to see if their church could begin supplementing a couple of contemporary hymns, to start their own praise team, to begin pursuing a contemporary worship service, because there was a great interest at the time from the community that was looking for a contemporary worship service. And this small group of adult members, they got together, and they worked together as the body of Christ. They offered to gather all of the music. They gathered regularly to practice. They recruited interested members to lead the songs. They put in so much work, so much time, so much effort. And they showcased their hard work for the glory of God in the church for about a month or two. However, this newly emerging ministry, it came to a screeching halt because a spirit of disunity began to enter into the church. Because another small group of members who had an overwhelming amount of influence in the church rose up. Their influence was rooted in the fact that they were founding members of the church. Their root of influence was founded in the fact that they provided large amounts of money to support the church. Their roots of influence were rooted in the fact that they were active leaders in an already established ministry of traditional music. And I will never forget when the day came, when it came to a vote in the congregation of whether it was going to be pursued or not, that a contemporary worship would happen. And what troubles my heart to this day were the comments that reflected the spirit of disunity in the church. I remember hearing comments like this come from people's mouths to another member of the body of Christ. Contemporary music is never going to enter this congregation. We are a traditional church. I'll never forget it when I heard people say, we provide the most funding for this church, so we have the biggest say in what goes on here. You have no place with what you are trying to do. Such hurtful statements, such a spirit of disunity aimed toward members trying to be innovative, trying to be imaginative, trying to create something new that would help the body of Christ to grow and connect others who had a desire to be a part of the church. This matter slowly but surely grew into an even bigger problem, you see, because this spirit of disunity, it began to grow. The spirit of disunity began to create division between members involving traditional and contemporary worship. Instead of unity re-entering the picture, the division, it only got worse and worse. A contemporary service was never added. The few members who had their great influence, they had won their stake. But oh, what a very great price that their victory had come by. The church membership fell to shambles. In the moment of the decision, about 25% of the members left. And as time passed on, as no contemporary elements were added, the membership had kept dwindling. The church has since lost at least 70% of its membership that it once maintained. And all of this happened because one part of the body said to another part of the body, I do not need you. Beloved in the Lord, this is the story of a church that once had a great chance, that once had a great opportunity to grow into something much more in the name of Jesus Christ, to reach even more and more people in the community. This story serves as a warning, as Paul reminds us, if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. I want to show you another object of interest here that will help us consider this profound mystery a little bit more. You all know what this is. Perhaps you have all played with this toy at some point in your life, a Mr. Potato Head. And I love Mr. Potato Head because he's made up of many parts. He's a great example of what the church should be. The church isn't just founded on ears, or arms, or eyes, or a nose, or a mustache, or a mouth, or even the feet. The church is founded, and it's reflected best when all the parts of the body are united. You see Mr. Potato Head when all of his parts are put together. You see the full revelation of Christ when the body of Christ is united in a true fellowship of love, in a true spirit of unity. But when the
the spirit of disunity enters into the church, or when the spirit of disunity enters into Mr. Potato Head, for example, a very big problem arises. There before you is the consequence of the spirit of disunity. Look at Mr. Potato Head now. Consider if that was the church that I just threw up into the air, and the spirit of disunity has arisen into it. It falls apart. The pieces of Mr. Potato Head, the pieces of the church, they break into many broken pieces that are not so easily put back together again. Beloved, I told you this story. I used Mr. Potato Head as a demonstration because the same thing can happen here at Grace Chapel. It is possible for division and dissension to happen in our church as we decide on where to go next, as we ponder what to do next. That's why I'm taking so much time, so much effort today to remind us all that we need to work together at all times. Everyone in this congregation is a member of the Christian church. We are all one part of the body of Christ. We are all different parts of the body, but we each play such a fundamental role in making sure that our church reaches people in St. Louis. We need to make sure that our current ministries and our new ministries moving forward are in the spirit of 1 Corinthians 12. Grace Chapel has had so much success because God has blessed us with many gifts, and so many people have been willing to give of themselves to accept the call of service in a variety of ways. Consider the bulletin that you're holding in your hand, the scheduling of events that are available for the week, the list of people that are there for you to pray for. All of these come forth from the efforts of individuals who work together to type, to fold, to stuff the information, to organize it all for you so that you know what's going on. The PowerPoints, the sound systems, the lights that are in our sanctuary now. All of this is tended by members who sacrifice their effort and their time so that you can have a more ordered, so that you can have a more meaningful worship experience. There are hours of music preparation so that we can all sing together as one united voice, lifting up our praises to God. There are so many other ways that I can't even list all of them. So many ways the member of body, the body parts of Christ do wonderful and amazing things. We have volunteers in the church office, principals and teachers who diligently instruct school students, committee leaders, money counters who come every week to make sure all of the offerings go to the right place. And there's so many other things. And as we move forward into starting new ministries at Grace Chapel, this same unitedness, this same connectedness is what's going to be needed. For example, Nathan and I have been talking for months now about starting a comfort dog ministry. And a lot of things are going to need to come together to make it happen. There's going to be financial support that will be needed. We're actually having a group from CCC come down in mid-February to begin answering our questions, to present what it is they do, to show us that maybe this can be a part of Grace. There will be a need for volunteers to help take care of the dog. There's going to be handlers that are needed to be prepared to go in difficult situations amongst the brokenhearted in our families and then within our community at large. So much prayer has gone into this process already, and continual prayer for discernment is going to be needed moving forward. This potential ministry will only be as effective as the unitedness that we bear and have with one another. I'll leave you with one more useful piece of imagery, one more useful piece of unity that I discovered reading over winter break, and I think is incredibly useful for the church to hear. I'll give you this illustration from the book version of The Wizard of Oz. So as Dorothy and company they're heading to the Emerald City to find those precious brains, to find the desired heart, to find the lost courage, to find and be returned home. But along the way, as they walk along that yellow brick road,
they stumble upon a field mouse that's being attacked by a predator, being chased around. And Dorothy and her friends, they manage to ward off the threat, and they save the mouse that was being attacked. Little did they know that they had actually saved royalty, because they find out after talking with the little mouse that she is actually the queen of the field mice. She's so thankful to all of her rescuers, and she gives them a whistle, telling them that if they ever run into trouble, to merely blow upon the whistle, and that help would soon find them. Well, as Dorothy and company keep traveling along the yellow brick road, eventually they find that they have to walk through a field of poppies. And these just aren't any poppies. These are magical poppies. These are poppies that any living thing that walks through them, they begin to be put under a spell of sleep. And not just a temporary sleep, an eternal sleep, never to wake up again. The Scarecrow and the Tin Woodman are unaffected because they are magically enchanted. They aren't living in the sense of flesh and blood. But the same could not be said for Dorothy, or Toto, or the Cowardly Lion. They get stuck in that magical poppy field. They begin to fall asleep. The Scarecrow and the Tin Woodman, they couldn't lift the Cowardly Lion up because of his great weight, but they were able to carry Toto and Dorothy to safety. Then the friends, they struggle, thinking about what they do. How can we save our dear friend the lion before it's too late? But they remembered the whistle that was given to them by the queen of the field mice, and they blow on the whistle, and shortly after, from all the corners of Oz, all of the field mice come together. They come before Dorothy and company. And together, the field mice, the Tin Woodman, the Scarecrow, Dorothy and Toto, they go out, they cut down a tree, they build a cart very quickly, they strap all the mice to this cart, and they run out back into the field of poppies. And they pick up the lion, they place him on the cart, and then before it was too late, the field mice, they carry the lion to safety. The lion was able to wake up from the sleep that almost got him. The lion was eternally grateful to all of his friends who saved his life. This part of the book was so stunning to me. It was such a helpful reminder that great obstacles can be overcome with the strong bonds of unity. It is together that great things are accomplished in the name of Jesus Christ. You are stronger together than you are divided. So let us pray, beloved, this morning a prayer for God to come into our hearts with a renewed sense of what it means to be the united body of Christ. We pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for everything that you give us. We are thankful that you have given us a church with so many people, with so many spiritual gifts who are willing to serve in a variety of ways. Heavenly Father, we ask in the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ, that you would break, that you would hinder every attitude and behavior in our church, that when we seek to vaunt our self-agendas at the expense of your will. Lord, we ask that you would bring all rivalries between us to an end, that any divisive attitudes that remain in our hearts, that you would break them, that you would rid of, that you would destroy any inappropriate priority of spiritual gifts. Lord, if we are failing, if we are falling into any of these sins, we ask that you would confront us with the power of your Holy Spirit, with the message of unity of 1 Corinthians 12, teaching us once more that the body of Christ is founded on the unity in love. Lord, help us to all understand the plans that you have for each of us in your church. Show each one of us how you plan to use us to serve others in St. Louis. Help us to grow in the word. Help us to realize our talents while at the same time finding ways where we can best serve in the church and serve one another. May we abide and remain in you always, Jesus' priceless treasure. Amen. The peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ bless and preserve you now and forever.
Thank you.
This morning we come as the body of Christ, asking for Christ's guidance, lifting up our requests for those who are sick, for the hospitalized, for Debbie Mays, for continued healing for Dick Horseman, Bev Lehman, Dorothy Carroll, Murphy Baker, Judith Hill, Jerry Everwine, Lana Gieselman, Doug Neely, Edna Burns, Mike Yarborough, Dan Sexton, Mark Ruback, Martha Gamarick, Kaylin Selden, Emma Wolschlager, Taryn Corbett Lundquist, and Dave Vance, the son-in-law of Dan and Sandy Hastings. For Ray Leshefsky and Jerry Meters as they continue their cancer treatments. For Reverend Ellery Glenn, the father of Reverend Micah Glenn, who was facing a lengthy recovery from surgery last week. For any who have moved into hospice care. For any of those who are mourning the loss of a loved one. We also give thanks this day for those who celebrate birthdays and anniversaries this week. For Kendall Perry on the 25th, for Shannon Quinn on the 25th, Amy Brawford on the 28th, David Kirsten on the 28th, Donna Yarborough on the 29th. For our school, our staff, and our students as we begin National Lutheran Schools Week. For this week's Grace Chapel School families, for Zachary King, Carson Bridget, DeMori Delancey, and Devin Donovan and Dawson Houston. For our men and women in uniform, military, fire, and police, and our EMS and first responders, along with doctors, nurses, and all workers in the medical field. I invite all the members of the church, the one body of Christ, to rise as we come before our Lord in prayer. Lord God, we give you thanks that you have gathered us together from our solitary lives to be a united family in the forgiveness of our sins. We thank you for your wonderful grace and mercy, which you have revealed to us and to the whole world in your Son, Jesus Christ. As we have faithfully heard your mighty word this day, cause our hearts to rejoice and respond in glad praise to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant unity and blessing to your whole church on earth. Give her peace and power to faithfully proclaim your perfect law and glorious gospel. Bless all preachers of your word and those who serve you in the world at their various vocations. Grant that many be drawn by your Spirit to join us in the fellowship of all the saints. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, graciously bless, protect, and defend our nation, its elected leaders, and especially those who serve bravely in the military and all the agencies that help and protect us. Bind all citizens of our country in a common allegiance and obedience to your will in the rule of law. Bless all who care for the poor, the downtrodden, and the lonely. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As your Son came to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, so bring comfort and healing to all who are sick or have any other adversity. Grant your help and blessing to all who minister to them in any need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And taught by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.